nothing perfect. I still stumble every single day. I still get knocked down, but the difference now is that's not where I stay. 'Cause I got a savior who knows everywhere. See your victories just up ahead. 'Cause there is a savior who knows everywhere you've been, and he's telling you that you never have to go back there again. So if you know
Hola. Good morning. It is so good to see each one of you here today. We're glad that you're able to come and be with us this morning. If you're visiting with us for the very first time, we especially want you to feel right at home and welcome. We are glad that you've taken time out of your day to come and worship with us. We hope that the Lord will move in our midst today. A few announcements and things that I do want to point out, some things that are in your bulletin and an invitation I want to give you. As I've been mentioning over the past couple weeks, I do want to invite you to come and be with us for the Little River Baptist Association annual meeting today. This afternoon at 3 o'clock is when the meeting will begin at Cadiz Baptist Church. There'll be a time of fellowship, and the evening worship service will begin at 4 o'clock. So if you say, hey, I don't really want to come for it all, just show up at 4 o'clock there at Cadiz Baptist. It'll be a great opportunity. Please hear my invitation. I would love to see you there. So come and worship with us there at Little River Association annual meeting at Cadiz Baptist. Service begins at 3, worship service begins at 4. Some announcements for this week. Tuesday night, our men's ministry is continuing to go. We have our 6-11 men that meet on the second and fourth Tuesday, so that'll be meeting this Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock. And also this week, our nursing home. So nursing home ministry Wednesday at 1 o'clock. Invite you to come and be a part of both of those things. Again, it is so good to see you this morning. At this time, let's go to the Lord in prayer as we begin our services today. Father, we are so thankful, Lord, to be able to come together and to be in your house. And God, we do pray, Lord, that you would come and move in our midst today. Father, we thank you for all that you do for us. And Lord, all that you continue, all the many ways that you continue to bless us. And God, we just pray that today, Lord, we'd be able to turn back and give you thanks and worship you as you deserve to be worshiped. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. Let's all stand, please, as we get ready to sing an old hymn, No, Not One.
There's not a friend like the Lord Jesus, no, not one, no, not one. None else could fill all our souls, Jesus, no, not one, no, not one. Jesus knows all about our struggles. He will guide till the day is done. There's not a friend like the Lord Jesus. No, not one. treasure that you painted for me. Love letter in the sky.
Good morning. Last Saturday, on a road east of Port-au-Prince, Haiti, after visiting an orphanage, driving a minibus, just like our buses out here, a group of 17 missionaries were hijacked and kidnapped. On Thursday of this week, the gang that kidnapped them sent a video stating that they wanted $1 million per prisoner as ransom. There were 16 from the United States and one from Canada. They were from Oregon, Ohio, Michigan, Wisconsin, Tennessee, Pennsylvania, and Ontario, Canada. In 2018, I had the opportunity to spend a week in Arcay, Haiti, at an orphanage called La Limie Ministries. I flew in to Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and I drove just an hour away on a minibus just like these missionaries. Ellen Humerick House is the founder and director of La Limia Ministries. And this week, she posted a blog. And I'd like to read you just a little bit of her blog. Haiti is a level 4 do not travel country and has been for a long time. In the past, it's been due to roadblocks and riots, robberies and protests. But now it's kidnappings. Though the others are still happening often, kidnapping is increasing rapidly in so many areas. Haitian, American, French, it doesn't matter where you're from or the color of your skin, the gangs are kidnapping people for ransom left and right, young and old, locals and foreigners. I've been told not to go to the grocery store in the city anytime soon. I haven't been in over a month. I've been warned not to renew my residence permit yet, not to go pick up my mail, not to go into the city at all. It's exhausting. We hear about the kidnappings. We see the faces of the victims, and then we wait to see if they make it. It's tiring because your friends that are Haitian know so much more about the situation than you do, and they say, forget the cheese and milk and the selection of flavored chips that can't be bought where we live. Eat a Haitian diet with whatever food can be found in your own little town. For us, that means rice and more rice. We need prayers, so many prayers. On your knees, begging to the Lord for safety, for security, for peace, and mostly for change. Change needs to come. It can't continue on like this. Divine intervention is needed, so pray like you've never prayed before. Please, for the victims, for the families, for the men, women, and children having to watch it all take place. Pray for the gangs, for the innocent lives, for the ministries, for the government. Just please pray. Since writing this blog and before posting it here, an article came out by the Washington Post on October the 9th. Here is some of what it said. Now, this is prior to the kidnappings this week. Haiti now holds the tragic title of highest per capita kidnapping rate on earth. Recorded kidnappings so far this year have spiked sixfold over the same period last year. During the first 6 months of the year, there were at least 395 kidnappings, more than four times the 88 during the same period last year. So I just ask you, as we leave here today and we go about our week, to remember Haiti in your prayers. Remember Ellen and her sweet girls. Remember La Limia Ministries, but most importantly right now, remember the 17 United States missionaries that have been kidnapped that don't know their fate as of right now. Would you say a prayer for us?
Would you join me as we pray? Father, we do come, Lord, asking, Lord, begging, Father, that you would be, especially with these missionaries, Lord, that have been put into a situation that none of us can even begin to fathom. God, we pray that you would be comfort and that you would be their strength. But Father, we also pray that you would be their rescuer, God, their deliverer. God, we not only pray for these, but Lord, all those who face these circumstances on a daily basis, they're serving in Haiti. God, we pray for Helen and La Limia, and Lord, we just pray that your hand would be upon them. Lord, and those that they serve. God, I pray that you would just be a strong and mighty tower. Lord, that you would be their refuge. God, that they can turn to in these times of great distress. Lord, again, we just pray that you would watch over and care for them. And Lord, we pray that you would be with them in a mighty way. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
So I'll stand once again, please. We'll sing, Holy is the Lord.
We stand and lift up our hands, for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing, everyone sing. the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God. Sin runs deep, your grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Amen, amen. I hope and pray that you know that you're not capable of making it through this life on your own. We each and every one of us, we desperately need the Lord. And I hope and pray that you know that. And this morning we're going to be in the book of James once more. James chapter 5 is where we'll be this morning. James chapter 5. We're going to look at verses 1 through 6 here in just a moment. Man, let me just pause right here to say how thankful I am for you all and for this church. This past week I had the great privilege on Thursday of going with our youth to Judgment House. I got put in charge of driving the middle school bus the middle school bus and walker, let me clarify. I got there, and as we arrived at Judgment House there in Princeton, Robbie Ann made the comment. She goes, "I didn't even think we didn't have another adult riding with you. It was just you and all those kids." I was like, felt right at home. But I say that to say this: thank you so much for not only allowing your students to come here, but to be a part of this youth group. And thank you all. You say, "Paxton, I don't have any kids in the youth group." Thank you for giving to our church, because it's because of your giving that we're able to go and to do things So every one of us are involved in that great ministry here at Liberty Point. So thank you for allowing your kids to be a part of that, or thank you for giving so that we can continue to do things with our youth group. James chapter 5, beginning in verse 1, if you found your place there, I invite you to stand with me if you're able as we honor the reading of God's word. James chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. The scripture says, "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you." Let's pray together. Father, we are thankful today, Lord, just for this opportunity to come and to worship you. And Father, now have the opportunity to be able to hear from you. And God, we pray that's exactly what takes place today. God, I confess, Lord, that we don't need to hear another sermon from Paxton. But God, we all desperately need to hear from you. So God, we pray that you would speak to our hearts today and let us leave here changed because of it. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. I heard the story of two bills that were on their way to be destroyed. Now, these bills were working their way down a conveyor belt at the Federal Reserve to be destroyed. They were worn out. And there was a $20 bill and a $1 bill. And they started talking to each other about what kind of life they had lived, about all the things that they had seen. And the $20 bill said, "Man, I've been a lot of places in my life. I've been at some of the nicest restaurants you can imagine. I've been on cruises. Man, I've traveled and I've seen some incredible places. How about you?" And he turns and looks at the $1 bill. And the $1 bill said, "Man, I've been to the Methodist Church, the Baptist Church, the Lutheran Church." And the $20 bill said, "Whoa, whoa, whoa. What's church?" I say that jokingly. I've already bragged on you because of your giving and what we're able to do. But I think a lot of times we forget that God is also concerned about what we do with our finances. And James this morning kind of drives that point home and gets to the heart of the matter and starts talking about what we do with our money and how important it is. The saying comedian said once, "If money talks, all it ever says to me is goodbye." Maybe that one fits you a little better. Maybe you understand and can relate to that. I know I certainly can. And maybe this morning you go, "Paxton," he starts off by saying, "Come now, you rich." So I get to take this Sunday off because obviously I don't fall into that rich category. So he's not speaking to me. And so let me just drive a point home real quick and then we'll get to the text. I don't know if you're aware or not, but there are 700 million people in the world who live on less than $2 a day. 700 million people that live on less than $2 a day. I would say that we would classify in our country as rich. Not only that, if you say, "Well, that's a little extreme, and that's only 700 million, what's that, about 10% of the world's population?" Well, let me make the number a little bit bigger. How about half the world? Half the world today lives on less than $5.50 a day. Half of the globe, less than $5.50 a day. So church, if you say, "Come now, you rich," doesn't apply to me, I think we need to check ourselves real quick. Because "come now, you rich" certainly applies to you and to me. And the point of the letter this morning, the point of James that he's trying to drive home, is not how much money you have anyway. James and God are not as concerned about how much money you have. That's not what this text is about. He's more concerned about two things that I think we'll pull out of the text this morning. It's not about how much money you have, but he is concerned about how you get it. He's concerned about how you get your wealth, and then he's concerned about what you do with it. And so as we walk through this together this morning, I think we'll see those two points, and be able to apply it to our lives this morning. So it's not about how much you have, but it's certainly about how you get it and what you do with it. So now let's walk through this together and see what God's word has to say to us. He says again, "Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you." Man, he's got a way with words, doesn't he? James has a reputation of being blunt, and this morning he's going to be as blunt as you can possibly be. So once again, James starts by saying, hey, let me say something to a particular group of you people. And this morning, the group of people that he's going to be speaking to are the people who are a little better off financially. But he says, come, I've got something to say to you wealthy people. And you can imagine as their ear turns as they listen to this. And then he says, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. He says, your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and your silver have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasures in the last days. So in these first three verses, James just hammers this point home, and he says, hey, you rich, come and listen, because I've got something to say to you. They turn their ear towards James, and he goes, go ahead and start crying now, because things are about to get worse for you. He says, matter of fact, all these things that you've laid up treasures, you've stored up treasures, and he says, all of it's going to pass away. None of it is going to last. Now, I know that you've heard the saying that you've never seen a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer, right? We can't take it with you when you go. You've heard all of those sayings. I heard the story of a wealthy, wealthy businessman who was on his deathbed. He's getting ready to pass away, and this guy has been in control his entire life, right? He's always had a plan and always worked his plan, and this one didn't catch him off guard. He had a plan for this moment as well. And so while he's on his deathbed, while he's still got his mind, everything is still okay, he calls in his three best friends. One's his business partner, one's his attorney, and one's his pastor. And he says, guys, I've been thinking about this and trying to prepare for when this day would come. And he said, so I've got a plan, and I want you guys to follow through with these instructions. He says, in this envelope that I'm giving each one of you an envelope, and in this envelope, there's $100,000 cash. He said, and what I want you to do, he said, because I trust you all more than I trust anyone else, he said, what I want you to do is on the day of my funeral, when I do pass, he said, I want each of you to come by the casket right before they close it, and each of you put this envelope with this money inside the casket. He said, I know it sounds crazy. He said, but I just can't help but think that I might need money after this life. And if it happens, if it just so happens, he said, I want to make sure I've got this with me. So when they, right before they shut the casket, each of you come by and put that envelope in the casket. Now I'm trusting you guys. And they all said, yeah, absolutely, absolutely, of course. So the man passes away, and sure enough, at the funeral, those three guys are the last three to pass by the casket, and right before the casket is shut, each one of them places an envelope in the casket. Several days later, they're all together, and these three guys, his business partner, his pastor, and his attorney are talking about things, and finally the business partner just says, you know what, guys, I got to be honest with you. Things are tough at our business since his passing. He said, and I just couldn't help but think that, man, just $20,000 would go a long way. He said, so I took $20,000 out of that envelope before I put it in the casket. And the pastor goes, oh, man, I got to be honest with you. It's so good to hear that, because things at the church have been crazy, and I thought, man, this is just a great opportunity for him to give one last time to the church. And he said, so I took $50,000 out of that $100,000 before I put it in the casket. And the attorney looked at him. He goes, I cannot believe you guys. This man trusted you all. And out of all the people in the world, he felt like he could trust us three more than anything. He said, I'm going to be honest with you guys. He said, I put all $100,000 in the envelope. He said, and if he can cash that check, he can have that money. You know, the saying is true. You can't take it with you when you go, right? And so James says, the things that you have worked so hard for, The things that you have spent so much time and energy on, he says, those things are going to rot and go away. Those things will not last forever. He says, your riches have rotted, your garments are moth-eaten, even your gold and your silver has corroded. And all of these things are speaking against you. Remember, James has been speaking up to this point about how selfish we can be as people, right? How when we focus on ourselves, it creates all sorts of problems. And James says if we focus on ourselves when it comes to our finances, he says we're headed in the wrong direction once more. So God is not concerned about how much you have, but he is concerned about how you got it. Verse 4 is where we find that first point. Verse 4 says, behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. James says that you're wealthy, but you're wealthy because you've taken things from people that weren't yours. You kept back the wages that they were owed, and you kept back those things, and you've made yourself wealthy by taking things from other people. Now, you might be saying, well, man, thank goodness he's talking about that because I don't have people that work for me, or maybe you're saying I've never kept back anything. But the point is this. God is concerned about how we gain what we have, right? He's concerned to make sure that we do things the right way. And what is the right way? Well, he says you got to make sure that you're treating people well even when you gain your wealth. Right, if you're gaining wealth off the backs of someone else, or if you're gaining wealth by swindling someone else or doing someone else wrong, James says that those people are crying out to God and God hears their prayers. So make sure that you're gaining your wealth the right way. God is concerned about how you get it. So if it's not above board, right, if you would be ashamed to talk about how you got money, then there's an issue there. James says that God is concerned with how you get it. But not only that, verse 5, he says, you have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. He's concerned about not only how we get it, but what we do with it. Right? James says that these people are rich because they've taken it from other people. They've got it from improper ways. And then what did they do with it? They made it all about me. You spent it on self-indulgence, he says. Right? So everything was focused on me, me, me. What can I get? What can I do? How can I make my life better or make my life more luxurious? And we see here in this passage that God is concerned about that. Now, don't misunderstand. Is James saying that you can't have nice things or do things that you want to do or enjoy? No, that's not what he's saying. But he's saying that your heart shows up in what you spend your money on, right? And these people are always focused on themselves. And that's what James has been saying all along. So, church, I want you to understand that what we spend our money on, what we spend our wealth on, tells us a lot about where our heart is. So this is just simply an indicator, a symptom, so to speak, right? If you've got health problems, you don't go and all of a sudden you walk into the doctor's office and you say, hey, doc, I've diagnosed myself. I've taken care of everything. I just need you to write the prescription, right? No, you when you go to the doctor, you say, hey, this is what's going on. These are some symptoms of some things that are taking place in my life. And then the doctor uses those symptoms to be able to diagnose what's taking place. James has given us some symptoms of a heart issue. James says, if you're spending your wealth on yourself, if you're spending your wealth to make your life better, if it's all focused on you, he says, that's a symptom of a greater problem. This isn't even the biggest problem. The biggest problem is the heart behind this issue. And so James would tell us very quickly that we need to look at how we are spending our wealth. He closes out by saying, you have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. James closes us out by saying that these are good people that you've done wrong. And God hears their cries for help. Now, as we quickly move to a close here, I can't help but think that so many times, maybe even this morning, you hear this and you go, Man, that's definitely not a message for me. But church, I want you to understand how blessed you truly are. Because when you hear the number of people who are living on less than $2 a day, it doesn't really resonate until you see them. Right? It doesn't really make sense until you lay eyes on them. My first international mission trip happened when I was about 15 years old. And I went to a place called Santa Emilia, Nicaragua. And in Santa Emilia, Nicaragua, we were working in a cow pasture. And we set up a medical clinic there. And I walked out and I saw these gentlemen who were walking out across this field with machetes. And they were doubled over, chopping the grass, laying this grass down in this pasture. And they worked all day long, doubled over with that machete, walking along, cutting the grass. The only time they stopped was to have a quick drink and to sharpen their machete once more, and then doubled over again, working across that field. And so I stopped them with a translator and began to talk with them. And I asked one of these guys, I said, I'm curious, man. I've never seen people work so hard, doubled over like this all day long. I said, I'm blown away. I said, how much are you making, if you don't mind me asking? They were making $1 a day. $1 a day to be doubled over, cutting grass with a machete. That was the first time I'd ever really experienced and put my eyes on extreme poverty, as it's classified in the world today. And James would tell us, if we're so focused on ourselves that we forget to see that there are other people living in a drastically different way, but church, can I be honest? You don't have to look across the borders of countries to see that kind of poverty. You don't have to look to Santa Emilia, Nicaragua. You don't have to look to faraway places. There are people who are struggling in our own community. And James says so clearly here that if we're not thinking about others, if all we think about is ourselves, that's where the issue lies. And so, church, I want to challenge you this morning to listen to what James says. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. The things that you've worked so hard for, your riches have rotted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver, the things that you've treasured, have corroded, and their corrosion will be evidenced against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You've laid up treasures in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. Church, I want you to hear loud and clear this morning that God is not against you having things, but he is concerned about how you got them. And then he is concerned about what you do with them. So I pray this morning, as we come to a close, that we ask him to give us a heart that's filled with a love for him and a love for people, that he would give us a heart that says, God, I want to use the things that you've blessed me with. God, the blessings that you've given to me, I want to use them to be able to serve others. I want to use them to be able to point people to Christ. I want to use them for your glory and not for mine. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for this time this morning. And God, I know that no one wants to come to church and hear about finances or hear about money. Lord, it's certainly not something that we want to deal with. But God, at the same time, Lord, it's a clear indicator of how selfish we can be at times. So God, as we've been examining ourselves through the book of James, and God, seeing how quickly we can make things about us, God, I pray this morning, Lord, if you see within us selfishness, God, if we're focused on ourselves when it comes to our finances, God, I pray that you would help us, Lord, to see how we might be better servants of you when it comes to those things. God, I pray that we wouldn't make this life about us in any way, shape, or form, but that, Father, we would live for you in all ways. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Would you stand with us?
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone. Can change a leper's spots and melt a heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
We're going to close in just a second, but this is my favorite verse, so we can't quit now. And so I want you to sing this verse and not just sing it because it's some words, but I want you to think about what it says and all that Christ has done for us. Let's sing again.
Which one? And when? Fourth verse, sorry. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Amen. I pray that you walk out of here knowing that you have his righteousness, not because of anything that you've done, but because of his riches, because he's the one that blesses us beyond anything we could ever imagine. Thank you so much for being here this morning. I do pray that if you have the opportunity, if you've got other things planned, I certainly understand, but if you have the opportunity, come out to Katie's Baptist today, 3:00 for the beginning of that meeting, 4:00 for the worship service. I'd love to see you there. It'd mean a lot to me. So if you have that opportunity, I'd love to see you today. Anything else on your hearts before we dismiss this morning? All right. Brother Rob, would you care to dismiss us in prayer this morning?